doesn't come down just because the lockdown has come down. So we need to be prepared in the hospital how to work and how to be safe. So we have three speakers, Dr. Professor Sarath from All India Institute, he'll be speaking on how to manage in the OP, and then Professor Rajshekhar from CMC Vellore, he'll be speaking on how to manage the ER as well as the emergency surgeries, and Professor Muthu Kumar, he'll be speaking on how to manage the elective cases in a safe way, not only to the health workers, but also to the patient. All of us know in the past 3 months that how the virus has spread from one country to 148 countries, and it is devastating. Though the fatality rate in COVID is 2.6% as compared to 9.6% in SARS-1 or the Middle East SARS 34%, but then because the number of people affected are high, so the number of deaths, this is an old statistic, the number of deaths is higher than the other two SARS. But the percentage of people, healthcare workers, affection is comparatively less if you compare with other SARS. But then because the estimated patients are high, so this 10 to 13% brings a huge number of healthcare workers who are affected with, can be affected with COVID. Now this came in April 15th when CDC estimated there are more than 9,000 health workers in US who are COVID positive. And India has not fallen far behind. In Mumbai itself, in April 11th, we had 100 healthcare workers who were COVID positive. But only the good news is that it doesn't happen. Most of the COVID positive among health workers, most of them were from the operation, not from the operation theater. They were mostly from the OPD and wards. So as a neurosurgeon, we have to be careful in the outpatient and the wards. And if you have a safe patient, then the theater also is safe. As we know, COVID, they transmit through droplets and aerosol. So both has to be taken care to prevent the spread. The most important is this, the asymptomatic period, the first 5 days. As we know that 30% will have no symptoms, and people who have mild to moderate symptoms also will come to our OP. So 85% of the people in the first 5 days still are contagious, and they can affect the healthcare workers. But we are not worried about this 15% who have severe symptoms. They can be detected, but these 85% people can come to our OP and cause problems to the healthcare workers. The lockdown period probably will reduce the delay the outbreak, but then it will not stop. After the lockdown, we still have cases will come. The only difference is if you had this outbreak, probably we could not have managed these patients, and then treatment would have been bad and mortality would have been 8 to 10%. But once the lockdown is over, once it's flattened, probably we can manage them. That's why the mortality will come down to 3%. But still after the lockdown, still we'll have a lot of cases which will be COVID positive or asymptomatic carriers. And so we should be careful from now onwards. We should be more careful from now onwards rather than what we were for the past 1 month. And how long it will last, we do not know. How it will behave, whether it will behave a recurring epidemic type, or it will have a first outbreak and persist, or it will get eradicated. So we do not know what will happen, because now even in China, they have cases which COVID negative patients are again getting, having second attacks of COVID. So we do not know herd immunity will come or not. So how do we start working in now and post lockdown period? How do we manage elective OPs? How do you manage ER and emergency neurosurgery? How do you manage operating theater? And is it essential to do COVID test for all patients like we do HIV or HBsAg for all patients? This is what we'll get answers from all our today's speakers. People who have questions, they can you write the question and answer in the Q&A box, or they can send a WhatsApp message to my number, can note down. 9618-117-118. It's preferable to use the Q&A box. And if you have problem with accessing Q&A box, send a WhatsApp message to 9618-117-118. Now with this, I'd like to request Dr. Sarath to start his lecture on how to manage the OPD with precautions.
Uh, So thank you very much, Dr. Manas, for giving a very nice introduction and also arranging and moderating this very important webinar. And I also thank my co-speakers, very experienced co-speakers, Professor Rajshekar, Professor Muthu Kumar, who have agreed to come in such a short time and speak in this very important webinar, which is a great concern for all of us, because this is something which none of us have witnessed, none of our parents have witnessed. It's a global happening. Things are changing so fast. People are worried. Doctors are worried not only about the patients, but about themselves as well as the families. And we thought this is the right time when we should have this webinar. So at the outset, I would like to speak about the neurosurgical management in the COVID pandemic, particularly in relationship to the protective gear, PPE, which all of us now, it's part of our lifestyle. We keep on hearing this day in and day out. How do we manage patients in our outpatient as well as inpatient? And a brief word about air conditioning. I mean, what is the latest knowledge about air conditioning and its relationship to the COVID? Now, all of us have heard the word PPE, which stands for personal protective equipment. And by when we mean PPE, the visualization of somebody wearing a complete coveralls with double protection, wearing this goggles, face shields, comes into your mind. But PPE or personal protective gear can mean any of these things. It doesn't just necessarily mean the complete level 3 gear. It can consist of any of the protective devices which can help us to prevent us to get infection. And obviously, there has to be a certain amount of rationing and certain amount of protocol set, because it's just impossible for everybody to wear those level 3 PPEs. Now, I found this very nice slide from the WHO, which says that it's very important, particularly in this era, in this pandemic, to optimize the availability of PPE, which is an issue even in the most richest countries. So obviously in India, thankfully because of the lockdown, we are not seeing such a huge number of cases coming to hospitals. And definitely we are seeing most of the patients not so serious, who are not very sick, we don't know how the situation is going to change tomorrow. So to minimize the use of PPE, it's very important for us to have a paradigm shift in the way we treat our patients or we see our patients. And as of today, it has been advised that we should adopt to other mechanisms like telemedicine or conference calls, especially for our follow-up cases. And if we have any suspected cases, we can have a screening tool and they could be asked to go to the COVID-specific wards. And then we need to restrict our healthcare workers as well as the people working in hospitals, so that we can create strict compartments, so that a compartment which is exposed to patients is separate from the compartment which is administrative or in the OPD or in the wards, which I will speak a bit later. So a PPE, whether it is viral proof or not, is currently tested in a Coimbatore, and these are the various parameters on which it is tested. So for it to be viral proof, there has to be a number of stringent parameters. But again, one has to understand that there is no need for everyone to wear that absolute level 3 PPE everywhere. So this, I found it actually from a company's brochure, which I found it very useful, as compared to the brochure which was given out by the guidelines which was given out by the WHO. So fundamentally, we are looking at three types of protective wear. So one is the light one, and all these protective wears are defined by GSM, which stands for grams per square meter. Now, obviously, this is the level 3, which stands for 180 GSM. Now, believe me, this is very, very tough to wear. I have seen these suits, and if you put on the suits, you'll feel as if you're going to choke and die in another 5 or 10 minutes. So in Wuhan, they were able to wear it because when the epidemic broke, it was sub-zero temperatures, plus it was air conditioning, plus Wuhan was a center. So definitely, this has to be only worn by personnel who are there in the very hot areas. This intermediate kit, which is like the regular OT kit, and it could be worn by all OPD staff, pathology staff, radiology staff, ambulance staff, mortuary staff, OT staff, etc. And of course, we need to make some modifications when we use it in the operating room. And this is the lightest, which is worn by people, especially for canteen workers, administrative. Again, administrative staff, the WHO says that there is no need for them to wear a complete suit, but this is one of the options which is available. So now we look at level three, which is a complete PPE kit, what we think it is for COVID crisis. This obviously has to be worn by healthcare workers as well as the people who are directly interacting with the COVID patients or COVID positive patients. The only people who may not wear it are the visitors. Again, these visitors have to be restricted. But let us say there are some issues where the visitors have to meet the patients, in which case they have, it has been given in the WHO guidelines that they can wear a medical mask, gown and gloves. But again, I think we have to apply our individual intelligence as well as our own maturity when we are dealing with such things. So visitors, rather than visiting them physically, it is better that they can speak to them on phone through some kind of a telemedicine. Because again, if visitors go and meet their patients, again, they're going to carry the infection. They have to be quarantined. You know, again, there is a risk of spreading infection. The medium kit, which ranges anywhere between 50 to 70, 80 GSM, is something which can be worn by a majority of the staff, but definitely availability is also the issue. So it could be reduced for OPD staff by creating some kind of intelligent maneuvers. Pathology, radiology staff, ambulance staff obviously have to wear it. Even the mortuary staff have to wear it. Now in the OT, we will not prefer you to use this kind of glove. You need to have a face shield. You need to seal the areas completely. And if you look at the most ideal situation, we need to wear the level 3 PPE with a powered pumps, you know, which are quite expensive and it is very difficult to procure in a country like India. But then we can do some innovations by which I will show you a little later, which I think can also work out just as well. The lightest kit again is can be worn by various people in the outpatient department, waiting room, and so on. But again, this has to be intelligently tailored. The idea is that more than providing the protective gear for the entire hospital people, which I think is not feasible, it is important to divide the hospital and the working areas into strict compartments. So there is an admin compartment which doesn't interact with the patients at all. Then there is an OPD reception staff who, again, I will again talk about that later, but the whole philosophy is to divide them into as many watertight as compartments by trying to make as many changes as possible so that we will be able to prevent crossover of infection. Now, if you look at the level of level three kit, what I'm talking about, the actual PPE, when we go through the market, we can see that these prices range from 500 to 700. And it can go to up to as much as 12,000, 15,000 per kit, you know, which have this powered pumps, which because obviously when they are so thick, you cannot wear. So you need to have some kind of circulation through that. And obviously, you know, such providing such kind of PPE kits is not only feasible, and it's not feasible in India, but even in the most developing countries, it's very difficult to procure these things. But just for the sake of knowledge, I went to show that these are all the possibilities which is available. Now, most of the time we have to work, most of our hospitals have to work with PPEs which range between 500 to 700. And we need to make some kind of innovations ourselves so that we'll be able to work with it. Now, what could be the possible innovations? So I think now, again, this is an evidence not mentioned anywhere. There are evidence has to be created, but then necessity is mother of invention. So when we are faced with acute crisis, we have to do some kind of innovations because as surgeons, we know that whenever we have to take universal precautions like operating a HIV case or doing a biopsy for a prion disease and all that. These are the precautions we take. And like Dr. Manas has mentioned it, the infection of COVID in the operating rooms is very less because that is where we take maximum precautions. So obviously, I would suggest wearing triple gloves. So you have a shoe cover, put on at least double shoe covers. Now, most of the Indian PPEs, they have some kind of a, they're not properly authorized. And if you buy one of the inexpensive ones, there is a gap at the level of the neck. So that can be sealed with some kind of micropore. Again, you know, some kind of plastic, it can be sealed. Now, it's very important to invest on this kind of goggles. So if the hospital is not providing, I would advise everybody to buy this kind of goggles. They are slightly expensive, but again, you can reuse them. So every time your duty is over, you can use them. You can wipe it with sodium hypochlorite, wash it with the detergent, and again, clean it with sanitizers. You could also get it plasma sterilized, but again, that takes time. You could use micropore to seal all the exposure points, so that takes some time in donning. I would also prefer to use a face shield with goggles for people who are dealing with COVID patients, because again, that will provide a double protection. Because for some reason, if the patient, especially for nurses, if the patient brings out some kind of mucus, so the face shield can take the mucus, and then the goggles again will be a second layer of protection. It's very important to understand the correct level of sequencing for donning and doffing. So this is the donning and doffing. So it's very important to minimize the stuff, balance, have a sense of balance on what to use where, so that you can maximize the resources, divide manpower. Now, before the webinar started, I was discussing with Professor Rajshekar, and I will also tell you what is the protocol we are following in our hospital. And it's also important to now compartmentalize the hospital, because whether we like it or not, after the acute stage is over, the COVID infection is there to stay with us for, I think, for the next 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. It's going to have a huge impact on our professional as well as personal lifestyles. And so we need to kind of create a significant change in our workflows. And this is the sequence of donning and doffing, which I'm sure everybody is aware. I will show you a short video on what is the donning and doffing sequence, which you can find.
Namaste. On we from AIMS New Delhi would like to demonstrate the donning and doffing methods and drink water prior to entering the donning area. Remove all.
So Manas, this video runs for about 13 minutes. Obviously, there's no time. So yeah. I will skip this video so that people who are interested can see this. So it is the AIMS. If anybody wants, I can send the video. It can be easily seen on the YouTube. And there's also a link available in Neurology India in the upcoming issue for people to see this link. So these are the various types of masks which are available. But if I were to briefly compare various masks, we have this single-use masks, we have surgical masks, and we have this N95 respirator masks. So surprisingly, I didn't find too much of difference between the 3-ply surgical mask and respirator mask. But obviously, the surgical N95 mask is much more safer. What I personally do is, we have been given out these N95 masks by the hospital, which we reuse it for about 20 times and dispose it off. So when in hospital, I prefer to use a double mask. So I put a 3-5-ply mask over my N95 mask. So that way, if there are some fluids on the surgical mask, I could easily dispose that off. Now, all of you would have seen this kind of sequences, N95, N99. So this basically indicates an increase in degree of severity of the intensity of protection. So obviously, this is the most protective mask. But again, this is also most expensive. And in most cases, for our practical purposes, we can use an N95 with a surgical mask, and this double mask should be all right. And that is what they were also doing in Wuhan. Now, going up to this, these masks are pretty much expensive. Now, this is a comparison about the efficacy of various types of masks. So we have also seen the masks which also have a valve. So the valve obviously offers a better protection. But the problem of the valve is that it brings out the air from inside. So people nearby could be at a higher risk. So if you have a valve mask, again, it's expensive. You have to use it along with a surgical mask. But again, there's not too much of difference with an N95 mask. There is a mild reduction of efficacy, but more or less it's okay. And I think if you use a double mask, we should be good enough. Now, N95 mask recently, because of the shortage, people have found out that you can actually use it for 3 to 4 months. You can use, if you have 4 masks with you, you can circulate it. And that is what has happened in AIMS. You know, there is this video where they have given us this N95 masks, and they have shown us that how each N95 mask has to be kept in a brown envelope, and how each one has to be used and kept in the envelope, and you should mark it as 1. So this should be marked as 2, this is as 3, this is as 4, and this is an emergency mask, which is kept in a bigger envelope. So this has to be circulated for about, each mask has to be used about 5 times. So once it is used 5 times, after 20 days, they provide us another 4 set of masks. And this should not be exposed to sunlight. That is what we have been told. And it should be just kept inside the envelope in a dry place. And this video shows us on how it can be used. And I think because AIMS has tested this protocol, The same protocol can also be followed in other hospitals, but the masks have to be kept very, very carefully. They should not be disposed of or thrown here and there. Now, in the reception and outpatient staff, it's very important to reduce the patient burden, as I've told you, by follow patients on telemedicine. We have to increase the physical barriers. So I've seen a picture where they have put an additional row of chairs. Obviously, that was in the acute emergency. But otherwise, we need to create glass barriers so that the reception staff is not exposed. It comes through a different entry and it deals with the patients through the glass barrier, maybe through mics. Appointments should be taken with the doctors directly from mobile phone apps. Create glass barriers. So then alternate chairs being taped, like what I will show in the next image. Now, the level one care is only for other staff. Level two can be for faculty and residents. So these are the few images which I got from internet on how we can increase the physical distancing. I don't like the word social distancing because it has an emotional connotation. So basically, we are looking at physical distancing. Now, in our department, we made this checklist. Now, issue is, whenever we get an neurosurgical emergency, there is no way for us to know. I think this is a burning question for everybody. There is no way whether this guy is an asymptomatic barrier or he was a symptomatic. For instance, just yesterday night, we have had a major crisis in the neurology. So one of the patients who came with a stroke turned out to be COVID positive and some 20 people have gone on quarantine. I think we will keep on seeing such issues happening. You know, but there are mechanisms like we have done in our own department on how this could be minimized. You know, so since it's, I think, practically impossible anywhere in the country to test every patient who comes, even though it is the most ideal situation to be done. But I don't think practically it's possible. Even in USA, it's not possible. And I like to take opinion of Dr. Manas, Dr. Rashekar, and Dr. Muthukumar on that. But we made this checklist. So once we go through the checklist, just an exhaustive checklist, they could be divided into a COVID suspect and a non-COVID suspect. So the COVID suspect could be kept in a separate cubicle where the staff wears a level two gear. And till he comes positive, then the patient has to be managed. And of course, if it's an emergency, then they will have to be taken with all precautions to emergency. Now the question is, who are the people who can only wear a mask? So this is what has been bothering me. So I say, okay, there's so much of risk. So are there any people in the hospital who can just wear masks? So one is obviously patients, attendants who come, they can be provided a mask at the entry. They have to wear masks, not because, you know, they are, everybody else is giving infection, but we have to prevent infection from coming from them. The security suggested that they can wear gloves and mask. The OPD reception, again, gloves are suggested, but again, they should have strict barriers. The administration staff, again, there should be intelligent modifications so that they should have a totally separate entrance away from the patients. So again, they can follow the same kind of precautions with which the general public follows. So again, these are few recommendations which I have given using washing hands, hand sanitizers, and I think all of us know about it. But again, you know, even though we know about it, the problem is suddenly we make a mistake because we take this disease for granted. And one of my own colleagues who is a neurosurgeon in Rothschild in Paris, he was on ventilator and was almost saved from death. Dr. George Dorfmuller, a very nice pediatric epilepsy surgeon. And he was saying that you have to take exceptional precautions. By exceptional precautions doesn't mean that you are covered with PPE everywhere, but at every step think that if I do this, will I end up getting an infection? Now the question which Dr. Manas has raised is how do we manage in the acute phase and how do we go to chronic phase? I think in acute phase, all of us have stopped elective. We are doing emergencies. At AIIMS, in our department, we have a COVID suspect cubicle where the sister wears always gear. And if he ticks on any one of the checklists, he goes into that cubicle. He or she goes into the cubicle. We get the testing done. Now, question is, what do we do after lockdown? So we can also discuss about it. So we have already discussed what to wear while taking patient rounds. So while taking patient rounds in non-COVID ward, wearing the OT, the regular OT gown with gloves, with masks, I prefer a double mask with N95 as well as surgical mask because I reuse N95 mask, a surgical mask, I can dispose it off in the hospital itself. Then investing in good goggles is also strongly recommended. so that you can always keep your personal goggles, and before coming home you can always clean it. And in the acute phase, again, we can go through this. So we have to understand that we cannot do tests for everybody, not simply because of lack of logistical issues, because if a person is negative, it doesn't mean that he or she is negative. It could turn out to be positive. I think the only thing is presence of a heightened level of universal precautions, not just universal precautions, but a heightened level of universal precautions. And we have to understand it's not possible for us to have testing for every patient. Now, in our department, what we have done is we have divided into 3 teams. And that is what we have consciously taken a decision after having a faculty meeting. And I really appreciate Dr. Kale for taking this initiative. So we have, it could be a team A, B, and a substitute team, or a team A, B, and C. And each team could be on duty for a period of 1 week or 2 weeks and then go on quarantine for 2 weeks. So more recently, they are saying even 10 days is okay. But the idea is you work for some time and then you go on quarantine. When you're going on quarantine, it doesn't mean you're on vacation. I'm sorry. You are there strictly restricting to your house, and you are taking care of the pandemic by keeping yourself in quarantine along with your family. And it could be with your family members because you're not in a COVID ward. You're in a non-COVID ward. So each team also, we have split it up vertically. So for instance, in my team, I am overall in charge. So I have a faculty who goes for rounds only in the wards along with one resident. Then I have another faculty who does ICU rounds only with another resident. And they have one more faculty who is first on call for any emergencies. And we don't interact with any of this faculty. So even within the team, we have developed micro compartments. So, and we always, in the morning, we always talk to each other over conference calls. We don't physically meet each other, discuss each other's problems, crack some jokes, and then make sure that we don't meet each other. The reason is that if one of us gets exposed, then the whole team doesn't have to go into quarantine. And like I was telling you, I prefer the word physical distancing, because when we say social distancing, it kind of gives a very negative connotations. Now, the question is, at least in the acute pandemic, we cannot do electives. Electives will have to wear, but only challenge is, even I don't know what is the answer once the lockdown opens. Can we do electives? So the reason we cannot do electives is that even when the tests, we do all the tests, they're still 77-92%. Many centers, they found that even though the tests are negative, you still do a post-operative CT scan and you can find some kind of patterns in it to suggest it's COVID positive. And there is this nice paper which Dr. Rashikar has sent from Wuhan, where they have shown that when they have done elective surgeries for patients who are asymptomatic carriers, the mortality was as high as 20%. So when we subject these patients to elective surgeries, we are going to put their lives at risk. So I suggest even after the lockdown, we should do only those kind of elective surgeries which are very, very, very much mandatory, or which are somewhat like semi-emergency cases. And most of the other cold cases, which should wait till the intensity of the pandemic comes down much less. Now, the question is about chronic phase post-lockdown. Hopefully, there should be a curve flattening. All of us, I know, are worried about this. But there are some things which are very important. There will be significant changes in healthcare, both quality and the method of administration. So like one of the sayings of Charles Darwin, unless we change, unless we are flexible, we will not be able to survive the post-COVID era. And we can also expect significant changes in our lifestyle. We need to follow a heightened level of universal precautions, which means at least a mask, a gloves. And once you go back, taking care of your personal products, I'll show you one of those. And we all hope that after this, governments will be much more motivated to invest more in healthcare. Personally, I think the whole situation will persist. For Dr. Rashikar, Dr. Muthukumar, they can correct me, but I think it's going to be there at 2 years, 3 years, or till a vaccine or treatment is developed. So now it's very important during this period that we support each other. So we have to deal with psychological burden. So Dr. Muthukumar gave this nice concept of team huddles. By this, I don't mean that physically we go and huddle, but at least keeping in touch every day on phone. The people who are in leadership, they have to give enough motivation and reassurance. And this is a time for doctors and healthcare to support shoulder to shoulder, especially the junior staff, nurses who are the frontline workers. Very important for the private hospitals. It's very important not to remove anybody from jobs. Ensure that they are secure while they're working. And of course, when patients also come, when they also have a lot of psychological burden, it's very important for us to assure them that if you take adequate precautions, the risk of getting COVID is very low. Now, these are some things which most of us know, like we have, it needs to be a significant change of lifestyle. Personally, what I do is I don't carry anything. I just carry a mobile phone. I go in my OT scrubs. I don't even carry a pen. I just take one water bottle and I take a packed food and a disposable bag. And then once I finish everything, I inform my, I call up home saying that I'm coming here. So the moment I enter home, I clean everything with sanitizers, go immediately, take off the clothes, wash it myself, and then have a bath myself. So I think it's a very significant change of lifestyle, but we have to continue this if you have to go through this phase. Now, regarding air conditioning, I will wrap it up in another 2 minutes, but these are such important burning topics. Now, there has been a lot of controversies. Can we use air conditioning? Will it lead to more infection? I went through a lot of literature and I came across this very nice article, which is a Federation of European Heating, Ventilation and Air Conditioning Association. And they gave this document on April 3rd, 2020. And based on that, they have said that buildings which have mechanical ventilation, they should run 24/7. Or at least they should run 2 hours before you open and 2 hours after you shut down. This obviously are for offices, but for hospitals, they have to run 24/7. They have also suggested that they should set the CO2 point to lower, maybe 400 parts per million in order to assure operation at normal. Now, they have also said that in case some rooms have been vacated, please do not huddle the manpower together in one room. Try to spread manpower as much as possible and run all the air conditioners, whether the rooms are shut down or open. Now, it's very important to supply as much outside air as possible. So it has to be 100% outdoor air and no recirculation. And I'll show you what exactly we mean by this. And there should be an exhaust ventilation 24/7. Now, it's also important not to change the humidation set point, which is usually around 25% to 30%. People say that if you increase the humidity, the COVID infection will reduce, but that's not the fact. So the humidification should not be changed. Recirculation should be avoided at all costs. So for doing this, what is important is there is something called as a damper valve. So this damper valve should always be closed so that the air is always going, fresh air is going inside and return air exhaust is always going outside. So that is why it's very important to have a complete discussion with the engineering section so that these modifications could be made. Now, other things, small. Clean the ducts. And finally, hospitals having window air conditioners or split AC, independent split ACs, they are to be discouraged. Because the problem of split ACs is, again, it's a circulating air and it increases the risk of COVID infection, especially in a public place. So in a public place, you need to have a central air conditioner. So is air conditioning finally safe? Yes. If it is central, kept at high circulation with outside air closed dampeners. So the dampers have to be closed. Do not change the humidifier settings. Run it 24/7 or at least 2 to 3 hours before and after. Do not use individual window split ACs, especially in public areas. No use cleaning air ducts or clean filter, and you can clean filters as usual. So this is an article which is going to come by Dr. Timmappa Hegde. It's an unusual article which is going to come up in Neurology India. So he's written this beautiful article saying this shall also pass. So basically the article, gist of the article is, you know, somebody, King Solomon searches for a ring that brings happiness for people who are sad and sadness who are happy. And he goes on searching and finally he finds that ring. And then he finds something engraved on the ring. which says this also shall pass. So obviously we are in a crisis, but our humanity has seen bigger crisis, and I'm sure all of us will pass through this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sarah. Can you hear me? Hello.
So should Manas, should I take questions now or later?
No, the questions are at the end. Can you hear me or not?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. Now the second lecture is by Dr. Rajshekar.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. We'll have the questions.
I can't hear anybody.
We'll have the questions after all the three lectures. I'll request Professor Rajshekar to start his lecture on managing emergencies.
Good evening. Thank you, Manas, for inviting me.
I cannot hear Dr. Rajshekar. Can you put on my...
Hello? Manas, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Yeah, so I think Sarath is having some problems with his audio.
Dr. Muthukumar, I can hear Dr. Rajshekar.
Manas, my voice is not coming.
Your voice is coming. You have to unmute or something. I can hear you. Fantastic. You can start off, share your screen.
Yeah, there was some music going on in the background. Thank you, Manas, for organizing this very important webinar. So all of us as neurosurgeons are very well versed in the management of emergencies. This is our bread and butter, you know. This is something that we do daily for a living. So
you don't see your slides.
I'm there. It says for Hello? Me it's I think maybe it's whose slides are you seeing? My slides are on here. I'm seeing my slides on my screen.
So Manas, was my presentation audible?
Yes, it was.
Thank you.
Maybe Sarath has to be stopped.
Sarath has to stop share screen.
Yeah, he has to stop his share screen.
Sir, you stop share.
And should I do that or Sarath has to do it?
No, you have to do that.
I have to do that. Where should I go?
No, sir. Dr. Sharath, sir, you can wait, sir. Dr. Rajshekar, sir, now you can share your screen.
Yes.
Choose the... Yeah, now it's on.
Can everybody see now?
Yeah, now we can see.
Should I carry on?
Please.
Yeah. So as I was saying, see, all of you are very well-versed in the management of neurosurgical emergencies. And so you must be wondering, what am I doing here? So the reason that I'm making this presentation is something has changed. And that is that we are used to dealing with a situation where the focus of all our efforts, all our energies is the patient, because we are trying to save the patient's life. But in the present scenario, we are also trying to save the lives of the healthcare workers. That includes not only us, but all our co-workers. So we have a responsibility in a neurosurgical emergency, not only to the patient, but also to the healthcare workers who work with us. And whenever we are faced with such a situation, there is a possibility of competing interest. That means, in other words, what is the best interest of the patient need not necessarily be the best interest of the healthcare worker. So ultimately, it is possible that we may have to have trade-offs and compromise. I know this is not easy, but that is what we are dealing with. The setting of a neurosurgical emergency is well known to all of you. It could be in the emergency room, ICU, or in the ward. And all these settings have their differences in terms of the logistics with respect to space, personnel, and equipment. Of course, the ICU is probably the best place to deal with an emergency, but in some situations or in some hospitals, the emergency room is better than the ward or the other way around. So I have categorized neurosurgical emergency into three categories. The first is the hyperacute, where you have to act now. We don't have much time. We don't probably have even a few minutes. This is in the setting of a cardiorespiratory arrest, or a patient who's decerebrating. Then you have the acute emergency, where you probably have about an hour within which you can act and save the patient's life. Typically, these patients come to us with altered sensorium of around less than 14. And then the subacute, where we can take about a day. These are all, of course, arbitrary time periods that I have put here. This is a patient, for example, who has an altered sensorium of 14 by 15, or who's fully alert, but the imaging shows severely raised intracranial pressure. So before I go on to how to deal with the emergencies, I just want to make two points. The first is a universal truth that cannot be debated, that cannot be discussed, that cannot be questioned. And that is all patients are COVID positive. We have to start with the premise that everybody is COVID positive. And this brings me to the second very important point, which is non-negotiable. No PPE, no intervention. Patient arrests in front of you, you don't have a PPE, you do not intervene. This is non-negotiable. So let us look at hyperacute emergencies. So the first question that you ask yourself is resuscitation prudent? This is where the issue of the conflicting interest comes in. Because if we were not in this situation, say about 3 months ago, I don't think we would be debating this. If a patient arrests in front of us, we all know what we're going to do. We're going to intubate the patient. We're going to do all that it takes to resuscitate the patient. But no longer. We need to look at the situation carefully. So I've given some sort of scenarios, like based on a diagnosis. For example, a patient with a large ganglionic bleed. Probably not. Recurrent GBM, patient with multiple brain mets, or a large suspected GBM. Maybe you would sort of forego resuscitation in consultation with the, talking to the relatives. Similarly, you come across a patient who has non-reacting pupils for you don't know how long. He's been just brought in saying he's been unconscious in the same state for like several hours. Maybe you don't want to resuscitate this patient. So ultimately, you have to balance the risk of successful outcome against the risk of exposure, not only to yourself, but the others around you. And of course, there are these absolute no-nos, no mouth-to-mouth, no ambu-bag ventilation. This is universally accepted. What about bedside neurosurgical procedures? Sometimes you are called upon to do this in an hyperacute emergency. Avoid as far as possible, but maybe you have to go and do this occasionally. Try and buy time with other medical measures to lower the ICP. So the procedures that I would say, of course, again, remember, no PPE, no intervention. So if you have all prepared with the PPEs, not only you, but all the other healthcare workers around, you could probably do an external ventricular drainage, twistle craniostomies for chronic subdural hematomas or abscess in a hyperacute emergency situation. What about acute and subacute? You have a little bit of time. And here, I think you have to try and elicit any history that points to the possible presence of COVID disease in the patient. I'll come to that in the next slide, how do you go about it. I personally believe that every patient undergoing surgery should have screening. I know we don't have the tests yet. Maybe we are not permitted to do it, but this is what we are looking at in the long-term situation. The sensitivity of RT-PCR is only about 40 to 50% for asymptomatic. So like Sarath said, a negative test doesn't mean this patient is not carrying the or not a carrier for the COVID, the coronavirus. Probably a combination of RT-PCR, sorry for the typo there, with IgM antibody test gives the best combination of about 80 to 90% in an asymptomatic patient, but like all of you know, the antibody test is not with us yet. And as far as possible, all procedures should be done in the operating room. So I have this syndromic diagnosis put together by two very eminent clinicians, one a virologist, Professor Jacob T. John and Professor Sheshadri, who have put together this diagnostic sort of criteria, which if any one of you is interested, I can share with you later because this is quite detailed. And then how you arrive at a diagnosis, mind you, this is without any testing for COVID. So with this mandatory criterion plus so on and so forth, we could use this to try and figure out whether the patient is likely to be COVID positive or not. Again, I want to share with you a few important publications before I go on to how to manage the emergencies. One has already been talked about by Sarath about the high mortality in patients who underwent surgery when they were asymptomatic, 20.5%. So they suggested that surgery might accelerate and exacerbate COVID and increase the mortality. There are several limitations to this article. They don't give you a denominator. They only took patients who turned positive after being asymptomatic. We don't know how many underwent surgery and did not turn positive. But the implications of this study are asymptomatic patients have a high risk of becoming positive and higher mortality. And therefore, I think it's worthwhile counseling every patient who's going to undergo surgery, elective, acute, subacute, whatever, that they may develop COVID in the postoperative period because surgery seems to exacerbate this disease and they have a risk for mortality. This is a very important paper. This is just published in NEJM 4 days ago. They looked at 215 pregnant women who were all asymptomatic initially, except for four. So 211 without symptoms, all were afebrile on admissions. 210 underwent nasopharyngeal swabs and 14% were positive. In other words, about 90% had no symptoms of COVID-19 at presentation, and therefore this group in New York suggests that there should be universal screening for COVID in women admitted for delivery. And this is the recommendation from the WINS-CNS Neuro-Oncology section just published. Again, they recommend all patients should undergo preoperative testing for COVID. So what are the benefits of universal testing? We could use the COVID-19 status to determine hospital isolation practices, and it guides the use of PPE. Like I said, there are a lot of limitations. We can discuss about this later, but as of now, these are the recommendations. So let us look at emergency surgery itself. I'll just leave you with four principles. One, choose the intervention that least exposes the surgeon and OR personnel to aerosol and blood. By the way, there is some evidence that these patients also have a viremia. This has come from the orthopedic surgeons, and therefore they suggest even exposure to blood is not good. So for example, for an aneurysm, maybe you should go for coiling. Colloid cyst with hydrocephalus, just do a shunt. Forget about removing the colloid cyst for now. Abscess, don't try to excise it, aspirate. Pituitary apoplexy, maybe a craniotomy. Keep surgery as short as possible because PPEs with N95 masks is very uncomfortable for prolonged use. I've been told by people who have done surgery with the N95 mask. Keep only personnel actively involved in the OR. That means during intubation and extubation, everybody steps out except the anesthesia team. Work in teams. Have one group of surgeons opening, another for the main surgery, and one for the closing. Again, may or may not be feasible, but try and limit the exposure. And finally, every patient who's been operated should have post-operative monitoring and testing for COVID. Because again, this comes from the Wuhan study where surgery seems to exacerbate symptoms of and the development of COVID. So I just want to finish by saying that I think we are in an era, probably for several months, if not years, where we have a new paradigm in managing neurosurgical emergencies. It's not business as usual. We have to balance the risk to healthcare workers with the patient's well-being. And I would strongly, of course, recommend using universal testing whenever it is permitted by the government and the ICMR, and try to be prudent with the surgeries and the techniques that you use to minimize exposure to aerosol and blood. And finally, I would make a plea for universal antibody testing for all healthcare workers. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Rajshekar, for making clear that means COVID has to be done mandatory, but then COVID has to be done, if it's a PCR test, probably one has to do two times before taking for surgery. I hope the government allows a routine test. I now request Professor Muthukumar to speak on operating theater protocols.
Are you able to see my slides?
Yes, we can see.
Thank you, Manas. Good evening to one and all. Now, in this particular presentation, I'll be talking about the operating theater protocol for neurosurgery during the COVID pandemic. And this is going to be, this includes both elective as well as emergency surgeries. Now, the aim of this protocol is to protect, as Rajshekar said, both the patients and the staff. In fact, we have been conditioned for years to wear protective wear, a PPE, to prevent the spread of infection from the surgical team to the patient. Now it's the other way around. An effort is taken to prevent the spread of infection from the patient to the healthcare worker. So this topic is divided into four stages. One is what are the changes we should that to take place in the OT infrastructure and the anesthesia protocol changes, changes in the surgery, and changes in the post-op care. Basically, the aim of all these to reduce the generation of aerosols during all these procedures. Now, ideally speaking, we should have a negative pressure operating theater for patients who are suspected or proven COVID positive. So this NPOT is a concept. I went through the literature. NPOTs on what are known as negative pressure ICUs are existent even in the developing world only in 25 to 30% of the hospitals. And most centers of India, in India, to my knowledge, do not have this. So in the absence of a negative pressure OT, what should we do? As Sarath has pointed out, we should increase the room air exchange, at least 20 to 25 exchanges per hour what is recommended. And if time permits during the discussion time, I'll tell you in more detail. There are publications from South Korea and Singapore where they have shown how by certain structural changes, simple structural changes, it is possible to convert an existing routine theater into a negative pressure theater. Now, during this pandemic and thereafter, as this is going to stay, as pointed out by Sarath and Rajshekar, it's going to stay with us for quite a few months, if not a year or more. So we have to have a dedicated OR complex dedicated to this particular taking up patients with suspected or proven COVID positive cases. And this should be separate from the main OR complex so that the rest of the patients do not get infected. And this OR complex should have the ventilation shaft, both the intake and outtake ventilation shaft should have what is known as a HEPA filter, high efficiency particulate air filter, so that the air that comes in and the air that goes out filters all those particles that are larger than 0.3 micron. And it's extremely important that we lock all the doors. Many of our OTs have more than one door. So it is extremely important we lock all the doors and only one entry exit point should be there from the scrub area. And there should be a very clear plan of action in the form of charts so that once the team go and the patients go into the theater, there should be no need to open the exit. And a separate anesthesiologist should take care of patients. One or two anesthesiologists should be dedicated to the care of COVID-positive patients or suspected COVID-positive patients. And they should not be involved in the care of other patients, routine patients who are COVID-negative. And all anesthetic equipments, including laptop computers, CRM machines, etc., should be covered with that plastic wrap to decrease the chance of contamination and also to facilitate cleaning. This is a snapshot I have taken from one of the recent publications from a hospital in Singapore, how all these are covered. At the end of the procedures, all these plastic wraps are properly disposed and the equipments are clean, which we will discuss a short while later. Now, the number of staff required for the procedure should be predetermined and only the bare minimum staff should be take part in the surgery. And after surgery, the anesthesia breathing circuit and the soda lime should be routinely changed. All single-use equipments, as expected, as we have been doing all along, should be discarded in the designated bioassert bags. on all these instruments that have been used for the suspected or proven COVID positive patients should be sent separately for decontamination. They should not be mixed with the rest of the instruments. And after the procedure, all the surfaces of the medical equipment should be cleaned with quaternary ammonium chloride disinfectants. And the entire OT is cleaned with sodium hypochlorite solution, and it should be appropriately sterilized. And the turn, there should be at least 1 hour turnover on time between two procedures. And extremely important that we maintain as a register where the names of all the participating staff, including the housekeeping staff up to the surgeons, everything should be entered for each procedure, because if one turns out to be positive, this will facilitate contact tracing. And it may look a little ridiculous, but we know some of the things we routinely take for granted, like pens, can be a source of contamination. So everybody who comes into the theater should not bring in any pens, because the anesthesia people and the floor nurse will routinely use a pen to tick off the different charts. So they should be provided with disposable pens, which are appropriately discarded at the end of the procedure. And all the phones should be in hands-free mode only. All the phones should be in hands-free mode only. Even the landline phones should be in hands-free mode only. Nobody should touch it, because the phone will be covered with a plastic sheet, as I had shown in the previous slide. And as I mentioned earlier, the OT door should remain shut during the entire procedure. Preferably, it should not be opened. But it is habits die hard. So even if you plan very, very accurately, there may be an equipment which may we may require, or the anesthetist might require a drug. So in that event, there should be a runner in the ante room outside the theater who is fully donned with PPE, who can get us that. And I, as mentioned by Sarath, a team huddle. By team huddle, I don't mean the team huddle that physically close contact team huddle that takes place during this basketball and rugby matches. It's physically distanced team huddle, by which I mean all the members of the participating in the surgery, including the anesthetist, up to the staff nurses, floor nurses, etc., should have a team huddle, so that the entire sequence is planned, so that everything takes place seamlessly. This reduces the chance of asking for new equipments and drug during the middle of surgery. And it is one more reason why this is required, is that people who have done this particular type of with donning full PPE, they have told me it's extremely difficult to communicate with your even with your scrub nurse and assistant once you don it. So it is deep. So it's, communication becomes difficult. That's one more reason why we should plan everything beforehand. And as far as anesthesia is concerned, the chance of why should as you know, surgeons, we should be bothered about anesthesia. This anesthesia, all intubation and extubation, and that is the stage of the procedure which has the highest chance of aerosol generation. So once the aerosol is generated during intubation, that once the surgical team goes inside, the entire team is at risk for infection. So it's, and we should play the, your anesthetist. Of course, the Indian Society of Anesthesiology has come out with clear-cut guidelines, which are there available in their website and is published in the latest issue of the journal also. But it's one of the greatest risk for healthcare workers is during intubation and extubation. And as I mentioned,
it's 8 o'clock.
As I mentioned earlier, all the patients should be taken only in the dedicated COVID OT. And one of the important points we have to remember is all the patients are normally brought to the pre-medication room. This should not take place in a suspected or a proven COVID patient. From the ward, from the COVID ward, the patient should directly go, preferably through a dedicated corridor, into the OT. There should be no waiting in the pre-medication room, because the chance of contamination, the contagion spreading to the other patients, is high. And the same anesthesia machine should be preferably used for all COVID cases during the entire duration of the pandemic. If necessary, more than one anesthesia machine can be used. And at any cost, awake intubation should be avoided, because there's a greater chance of patient coughing during that procedure. And it is necessary to place a HIPAA filters both at the inspiratory and expiratory limbs of the circuit, in the anesthetic circuit. And one of the, we should every chance of disconnection of the anesthesia circuit should be anticipated and prevented, because after intubation, normally what our anesthetists, many times it happens is they find the length is not sufficient, they will add an extra tubing. If this is anticipated, it should be added to the circuit before intubation, because it should not, if you add it after intubation, the chance of the circuit getting opened there and the error session occur is more. And the intubation should take place with the inside a transparent plastic box. I am sure the social media is, there are plenty of videos in social media which have shown us how to intubate with this plastic transparent box. Even the website of the Indian Society of Anesthesiology has this video. And preferably all intubation should take place via video laryngoscopy only, because it increases the distance between the patient's face and the person who is intubating. And it has also been shown that with the wearing a full hazmat suit, it is difficult for the anesthetist to, the vision of the anesthetist is compromised. And it's extremely important that pre-oxygenation should be carried out via well-fitting face masks. If the face mask is not well-fitting, then during bagging, the chance of the aerosol generation is more. And preferably, a rapid sequence intubation should be is preferable. And if bag mask ventilation is not avoidable, the anesthetist should use low tidal volumes and low pressure. And one more thing that should be very careful, should be noted, is that before intubation, when the anesthetist removes the mask, he or she has to make sure that the patient expires fully into the mask before the mask is lifted off the patient, even if it is done within the intubation box. And only the most experienced anesthetist should be asked to intubate this patient, because it should be done very quickly, because this is the stage where the aerosol generation is very likely to occur. And if ET tube suctioning is required during the procedure, there should be a facility for continuous inline suctioning. There is no question of disconnecting the circuit, applying a suction and connecting the circuit, because that once again generates aerosol formation. We should be liberal in the use of antiemetics, because to reduce the chance of postoperative retching, and it's extremely important. That's a very simple procedure that will protect the anesthetist and other healthcare workers, is to apply a steroid ray over the entire face, so that even if there's going to be some secretion oozing out of the patient's mouth or nose, then the chance of contamination, droplet contamination to the anesthetist, the scrub nurse, will be reduced. And extubation should be smooth without coughing and retching. And that is one more reason why you should have an experienced anesthetist. And immediately after extubation, the patient should wear a surgical mask, and supplemental oxygen may be administered by nasal cones under the surgical mask. In fact, the Indian Society of Anesthesiology has suggested the patient should fully recover in the OT room itself. The patient should not be taken to the recovery room. From the OT, the patient, after having fully recovered, should go directly to the ICU or the postoperative ward, preferably through a dedicated corridor which is covered with plastic sheets, so that the plastic sheets should be periodically replaced. And the people who, the nursing staff and the stretcher bearers who are shifting the patient, should be in fully donned with full PPE. And how do you choose cases during this pandemic? It's extremely difficult to do that. It should be done on an individual basis, but it should be, we should take into consideration the national and the guidelines provided by the government as well as the ICMR. But all these guidelines should be applied, taking into consideration the infrastructure that is available in our hospital. And make sure that these guidelines will change. Once there's a surge in cases, these guidelines may change as the caseload comes down. Once again, the guidelines may change. So we need to keep ourselves updated about these guidelines also. And ANS has come out with a tired recommendation for choosing cases. This tired framework is recommended because, as pointed out by Sarath, it conserves the resources. And it also reduces the burden on the existing healthcare system. This is the CMC Vellore model, which we have been circulated all NSI members in the 1st of April. But this is not meant for neurosurgery specifically. This is meant for general surgery. And the Italian neurosurgeons have come out with a model of choosing cases for neuro-oncology, which is a three-tiered model. But the model which I would like to emphasize today is what is provided by EANS, which consists of three tiers. Tier one consists of low acuity surgery, like craniosynostosis surgery, cranioplasties, etc., which can be postponed. Tier two consists of intermediate acuity surgery. For example, if it's a surgery for a low-grade glioma or an incidentally discovered pituitary adenoma or incidentally discovered aneurysm, it can be postponed to a reasonable point of time. Whereas tier three is a high acuity surgery. For example, a patient with an extradural hematoma or a rapidly deteriorating consciousness or a high-grade glioma with mass effect. These cannot be postponed. Now, this is something which not highlighted in the medical literature, which I accidentally came across in Business Standard newspaper 2 days ago. And blood banks in Mumbai, they have found an 80% drop in voluntary blood donors because of the lockdown. And even after the lockdown is lifted, it's very unlikely that the donors are going to come to the hospital to donate blood. So this is going to be a problem. So we are going to face this particular problem in future, even after the lockdown is lifted. So we have to make sure that, suppose unfortunately our patient has a rare blood loop, we have to make sure that the adequate blood is available before we take up the case for surgery. Now, regarding the surgical procedure, the aim is to avoid or minimize the use of drills, because drills, this is especially our neurosurgical drills have a RPM ranging from 60 to 80,000 RPMs. They can generate considerable aerosols. And if you are doing a craniotomy, it's preferable to use conventional, the age-old Hudson's brace and giggly saws. And even then, copious irrigation of the surgical site is required. For spinal procedure also, try to minimize or avoid the use of drill, because this can lead to aerosol generation. And electrocautery, especially monopolar cautery, can generate smoke. Normally also we suck out the smoke, but here we have to make sure that we have two large bore cannulas which in the field which quickly suck out the smoke, because that will lead to significant aerosol generation. And this is the powered air purifying respirator. I think in certain countries where these are available, the infection of the healthcare worker is much less, mainly because if they have a negative pressure OT with a air purifying respirator, the chance of infection is less to the healthcare worker, but this is pretty expensive. This is an image which I got from my colleague in another city who purchased this just two days ago. It's pretty expensive, and it is useful for aerosol generating procedure, but as I have pointed out below, it is not possible to use, obviously not possible to use a microscope with this. Communication is difficult. What you are saying is your voice is muffled. You cannot communicate with your assistant, etc. And the battery, which is shown here in the right side image, lasts only for 4 hours. So it's not possible to do it for prolonged surgeries, maybe for emergency surgeries. Now, transphenoidal surgery, EANS and several other societies have come out with guidelines. They have clearly mentioned transphenoidal surgery should be avoided at all costs. We should try to avoid transphenoidal surgery. And if a cranial surgery, all those cranial surgeries that require opening of a sinus should be either be avoided or modified accordingly. Now, postoperative care is very important. If the patient, the transportation of an intubated, if you are going to transport an intubated patient, once again, a filter should be placed between the ET tube and the back. And patient should be preferably placed in a what is known as a negative pressure ICU or an airborne infection isolation room, which is not available in most of our centers. But if the patient requires a supplemental oxygen, it should be given through a nasal prong under beneath the face mask. And the Indian Society of Anesthesiologists and the other societies have also mentioned that we should not use Venturi type of mask, as it's supposed to generate aerosol formation. Concluding is going to be a pandemic is not going to be a short-lived sprint. As pointed out by one of the articles in JBJS, which was published just 2 days ago, it's going to be a marathon rather than a short-lived sprint. And we need to change our mindset. It's going to be a behavioral change. It's going to cost, it is going to increase the healthcare expenditure, which is going to be a big burden for a country like India. And we need to unlearn and relearn several things. Right from the donning and doffing of the PPE, we have to unlearn and relearn. And this is going to be a red flag. This COVID is going to change the way we practice medicine. In fact, it may even change the entire social fabric in the years to come. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Muthukumar, for giving practical solutions to for the day-to-day theater work. And we have a lot of questions, and I'll go one by one, and I'll request all of you to answer. There's one question from Dr. Kaushik from Calcutta. He has asked about what should be done for the parents of pediatric patients in pediatric neurosurgery, for pediatric the neurosurgery children as well as the parents. Precautions. Because children, they may not cooperate with the mask and all those. And the question is for last Dr. Sarat. Sarat, you can hear me?
Hello. Yes. Can you hear me, Manas?
Yeah, I can hear you.
What is the question again? I've just unmuted myself.
Question is for what do you do for pediatric patients and what precaution you take for their parents in the OP? And the wards.
See, the same precautions as anybody else, because all the patients and the relatives, they should be considered as, like mentioned by Dr. Rajshekar, as probably COVID positive, which means they will have to wear masks. Then they will have to stay with the patients, with the child, and no specific.
Dr. Ashika said that there were a very high percentage, 13% of them were COVID positive, whether they are allowed breastfeeding or not.
Yeah, as far as I know, they had no problems. Initially, they said the infants were fed with banked breast milk. That was what was written in that article.
Yes,
they didn't allow them to feed directly. That is, those who were tested and found positive.
Okay.
Yeah, that was from that New England Journal of Medicine. I am not sure about what the other recommendations by the obstetricians are. But
if you assume so many are asymptomatic, should breastfeeding be avoided?
Manas, can I answer that question?
Yeah, please.
There are a couple of publications publications which say that if the mother is COVID positive, she can pump the breast milk and someone else can feed the she can pump the breast milk out.
Breast pump can be used and direct contact has to be avoided.
Direct contact, see I think at least a couple of cases have been reported where the COVID positive mother delivered a COVID negative child, because so far there's no evidence of vertical transmission. And subsequently the child became COVID positive because of breastfeeding. So what they now recommend is that mother should use a breast pump on
this is a question either Dr. Muthukumar or Dr. Sarath can answer. They have asked why a split AC should not be used.
Yes. Yeah. They have to use a split AC at home. But the main problem of split AC is that it is firstly based on recirculation. Secondly, most of the aerosol which is generated, it continues staying in the roof. So there is no active circulation with the split ACs. So that is the reason split ACs is not advisable in public. So in public, the only kind of air conditioners which are advisable are central air conditioners on high flow with the dampers closed so that the fresh air comes. This definitely is going to compromise on the cooling ability as well as the humidifiers. Definitely the level of cooling is going to go down. But that is something which again has to be tolerated if we need to avoid infection.
And why do you avoid, you said you should not keep the mask in sunlight.
That I really don't know. But they say that there is no need to keep in the mask. I don't want to say anything off the hat. I heard somebody saying something, but I don't want to mention that in this forum. But the recommendation is that you can put it in a paper bag and keep it in a dry place. And after 3 to 4 days, you can use it once again. So this way you can continue using it for about 5 times.
Manas, can I say something?
Yes.
In fact, even in countries with plenty of resources like Singapore and South Korea, they have difficulty in procuring these masks. So they have also started, and they have also in several publications, they have used the same the sequence like what Sarath showed. Have 5 or 6 masks, use them in sequence. So use them, and one of the important things that we have to take care while donning and doffing, I think the video which Sarath has shown, which is available in YouTube, beautiful video produced by the R&D Institute, Infectious Disease Department, which is also going to be provided as a supplement in the forthcoming issue of Neurology India. So that shows that we should, while removing the mask, we should not apply your hand on the outer surface of the mask. It should, you should take the lower, you should take it off by attaching the band. Your even a gloved hand should not come in contact with your outer surface of the mask. Sarath, do you have something?
Thank you, Dr. Muthukumar. Dr. Hemant Varathia from Jaipur has asked whether surgeons, neurosurgeons who are more than 65 years should work or take a break for 6 months.
We have addressed in our publication, which is going to come out in the next issue. There is ample evidence in the literature that people who are more than 60 have a greater chance of have higher morbidity and mortality from COVID, not only from COVID, from SARS also. So they should be preferably, if enough neurosurgeons are available, they should be benched. But by bench, I mean they should be taken off the routine OT and ward duties. They can be used for teleconsultations. So they need not be completely off the, they can take teleconsultations, and people even say they can be used for virtual ward rounds, so that the younger neurosurgeons who are less burdened, so that the younger neurosurgeons need not go to the OPD. The teleconsultations can be taken care of by people over 60 plus.
Yeah, this is again Dr. Narsimar from Hyderabad. He has asked, what is better? Means you stressed in your presentation, but if you answer again, whether giggly saw is better or a cutter is better for doing craniotomy?
See, all of us have now got used to this high-speed cutter. It will be very difficult for us to go back to giggly saw. But we have all seen how much of aerosol that is generated with a cutter. It's going to be at least some 60 to 65,000 RPM. It is not at all preferable to do it. And if you want to do it if you are going to drill the sphenoid ridge, because right now we are not doing any elective cases. At least I am not doing elective cases. I think most people don't do elective cases. But this is going to go, this pandemic is going to go on for several months. So at some stage, we have to start doing it. At that point of time, if I am asked to do a TRNL craniotomy, I would still go back and start rongering away the lesser wing of sphenoid rather than using drill.
So giggly saw is better than cutter.
Is better.
So Manas, can I add a word about the mask?
Yeah, please.
So personally, you know, we have been given the N95 masks to be used at the hospital. So I put a 3-ply surgical mask on the N95 mask, not because it's going to afford me more protection, but because if there is some fluid spilling, so my N95 mask is going to be less contaminated. So that way I can use it. So this is what I found it to be most useful. So rather than using a bare N95, you can use a 3-ply mask over the N95. I think that provides a very reasonable protection.
There's a question from Dr. Vamsi Krishna. This is for Dr. Rajshekhar. What dress should be worn from home? Is it scrubs from home and come back with the scrub home and wash separately, or go in regular dress and change your dress?
Oh, I think Sarath will answer that.
So I go to hospital in scrubs. I can tell you what exactly I do. So I go to hospital in scrubs. I don't wear socks. I just wear shoes. I just take a mobile phone. I take a water bottle and I take my food packed in a newspaper. So once I go to hospital, I can eat my lie. Of course, wash my hands in my room and I can drink the water. That's all I carry. And when coming in hospital, of course, when I have to go into the patient area, I put on the gown, I put on the cap, I put on the mask, I put double gloves, take the rounds. Once rounds are over, once I come onto the admin block, I remove the gloves. Then I can sit in the my room with only scrubs. I have given off to all my personal staff, my secretaries. So currently, I am the only person in the room. So this is the kind of lifestyle I'm following. And then when I have to go home, when I'm nearing the home, I give a call so that, of course, most of you would be following this. But I have a bucket outside my home, which is filled with some water mixed with sodium hypochlorite. So I dip my legs into that, go straight to the toilet, take off the clothes, put it in a bucket mixed with surf water, wash my own clothes, have a bath, and then come down. So I think, like Dr. Muthukumar was saying, this would become the new norm, being as minimalistic as possible. And if Dr. Rashika, Dr. Muthukumar, or Dr. Manas want to add something, they can add.
No, that's the ideal way to do, I think. Maybe you should have a restroom outside the house. So we have every bath and come inside the house. the next question is by Dr. AB. He has asked, if we are already exposed to COVID and we may have developed immunity, do we still need to take all these precautions?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Please don't take it lightly. Do not presume that you are positive. You don't have the antibody test. Yes, once the antibody test comes in and then you are positive, even then nobody really knows whether you're protected for life or not. Nobody has any clue right now. So even then, I would say, err on the side of protecting yourself rather than, you know, being gung-ho about it and saying, oh, now I'm protected. At least definitely not now unless you're tested for antibodies.
Manas, can I say something?
Yes.
This particular thing is very important because when this pandemic broke out, we were all under the impression, and even UK was under the impression, that if we develop herd immunity, it's everything will go away. Now, this concept of herd immunity, which we studied in SPM, it's becoming questionable. Now, in China and South Korea, and maybe even in Singapore, there are some cases which are COVID positive, they became negative, and once again, they become COVID positive. And we do not know whether it's reinfection or recurrence, and whether these patients are shedding virus. This is something which we do not know. This is a disease about which, I mean, we have a lot of, we are ignorant about this disease. So let us err on the side of caution, as Rajshekhar has said.
There's a question from Dr. Subodh Raju from Hyderabad. He has asked that what is the cost of screening test vis-a-vis an extensive PPE?
So, see, I would say that it's not one or the other. I think it's both if possible. And PPE, like I said in the beginning, no PPE, no intervention. That there is no doubt. And I think that's the way we are going to function for several months, if not years. So the testing is going to only help us conserve some resources probably and reallocate resources appropriately and so on and so forth. But as of now, we can't give up PPE because somebody is negative on the test. So both will go hand in hand. And the cost of a test, as far as I know, is about 4,500 rupees for the RT-PCR. The antibody tests are supposed to be cheaper, like 500 rupees. But, it's not one versus the other.
Yeah, Dr. Sarath wants to add.
Can I make a comment about the PPE?
Yeah.
The traditional hazmat suit, what is said to be the PPE for COVID, at least the Indian brands, what I have seen, it's impossible to wear. You put it on, in 5 minutes, you feel as if your whole body is sweating. So basically, especially in this tropical climate, so you need to be in some kind of air conditioning, and then you need a powered pump. Now you buy one of those PPE, they're terribly expensive. They cost about 8,000 to 10,000 rupees. Now even in PPE, there are different types. So the most inexpensive one ranges anywhere between 400 to 700 rupees. But again, we worry about the quality of that. Then the medium size anywhere ranges between 1,500 to 2,000 rupees. And the most expensive one is from 8,000 to 12,000 rupees, which is, the absolute protective one. But in one and two, it's very difficult to put that on. And I've seen even the WHO recommendations. So when we are taking rounds, wearing a good so-called HIV suit, where we have very good shoe covers, and then you're able to put on a gown, then you're able to put on double gloves, you put on a cap, put on two masks, one N95, one surgical mask, and then you're able to take rounds. That should kind of give you some kind of a barrier. Only thing is, if you get splashed, again, it becomes useless. But most of the time when we take rounds, you know, we don't usually get splashed. And for the nurses, it's very good to invest in goggles. No, like the picture I've showed, which is airtight and fits very nicely. So that is very important for protecting eye. And in addition to goggles, people should also have face shields, particularly the nurses who are dealing with the patients with suction. So again, you know, I would say that we have to evolve our own mechanisms. But if we think of those, that PPE, which has this hazmat suit and all that, it's, if you buy the most expensive one, it's terrible. One cannot wear. In Wuhan, maybe they've worn it because it was a sub-zero temperatures. But in our setting, we can't wear it everywhere. It's impossible. So I don't know if Dr. Rashekar or Dr. Muthukumar want to make any comments.
Apart from this, Sarath, what about the role of this visor, over wearing a visor over the surgical mask? You have a N95 mask and the surgical mask. You have a goggle. Over and above that, we are supposed to wear a visor, isn't it?
It is. Visor is especially meant for people who are doing, you know, so that there is some exposure of the skin and then the splash goes. So the visor kind of, I had a picture in my presentation, and I'm sure many of you would have seen that picture, which shows, I can just share
the slide.
So if you see the slide, so this is a fluorescent dye which has been expelled from a simulated patient cough that ended up on the laryngoscopist. So you can see the amount of splash which happens, and the same thing can happen with the patient where you have to do the suctioning or a tracheostomy. So in this age, you have to assume that this is the kind of splashes to which sisters will be exposed or nurse residents will be exposed. So that's the reason I suggested that the goggles could be yours, the N95 mask could be yours, but put another surgical mask on top of that to prevent any contamination of your N95 mask. Put a visor on that so that your goggles is less contaminated. So it's basically to give a double protection. So if you see one of those videos in Wuhan, they have made everything double or triple. So shoe covers, they put triple. Gloves, they put triple. So basically the whole idea is water, it's airtight, as many layers as possible to prevent the virus from entering. That's the principle.
Yeah, so we have a relevant question now from Dr. Manaranjita Kumar, Manaranjita from Jipmer, Pondicherry. Any specific procedure for precautions for transnasal procedure? As Dr. Muthukumar said that one has to do transcranial, but if we have to do anything, any specific precautions?
As of now, EANS recommendation and many other societies have recommended to avoid all transnasal procedures because there's a very high risk of healthcare worker becoming contaminated. In fact, if you can just quote Dr. Rajshekar, he said that without PPE, do not even resuscitate. So why go for a transnasal procedure? The only thing that is going to happen is a pituitary apoplexy.
Yeah, pituitary apoplexy, whether one has to do with the PPE or should not do.
It's risky to do. The chance of the healthcare, the surgeon and the team should be aware that doing a transmineral procedure has a high risk of the healthcare worker becoming infected.
Today I read an article, they have written that if it's an essential to do a transnasal procedure, at least have a 2 times COVID negative test, 3 days apart. And if it's negative, then with all precautions with PP, one can take the risk.
But if it is going to be a patient with a rapidly deteriorating vision, pituitary apoplexy, rapidly deteriorating vision, or still if there's going to be a altered sensorium, you can't wait for 2 tests, isn't it? You'll have to go in as soon as possible.
Yeah. The next question is...
Split AC. What is the duration between Dr. Suchanda from Hyderabad? He has asked, what is the duration between two successive surgeries and what all needs to be sanitized before taking a second case? This is to Dr. Muthukumar.
Yeah, because I said that minimum of 1 hour is required. This is based on the publications from Singapore and South Korea. They said they require, because all these equipments, first of all, we need to remove all the plastic wrappers and all these equipments, the equipments in the theater should be physically cleaned with the quaternary ammonium compounds. The theater wall, etc., should be cleaned with the sodium hypochlorite solution, and then it should be sterilized with hydrogen peroxide or ultraviolet, whichever form of sterilization you are going to use. So it's going to be a minimum of 1 hour gap is required between two procedures.
Is anesthesia, another question by Dr. Shankar Ganesh for you, is anesthesia machine without scavenging system safe in the context of COVID?
It's certainly not safe. In fact, one of the WhatsApp group discussions today morning, one colleague from another place had said that in the expiratory limb of the circuit, they place a suction. In fact, he had sent me just half an hour before the start of this webinar, he sent me a video. But I think it is very risky because you should have a HIPAA filter in both the inspiratory and expiratory limb of the circuit. So, a HIPAA filter in the inspiratory and expiratory limb of the circuit is a must. So the reason is all these things cannot be implemented now in the middle of a lockdown. After the lockdown is lifted, we are all certainly going to have a surge in cases, surge in neurosurgery cases. So at that point of time, it's better now to be prepared, inform our hospitals, these are the things we may need so that they are equipped adequately when the cases come.
This is a question from Dr. Maulik Vaza to Dr. Rajshekar. He has asked, should we revise our criteria for life-saving surgeries, as in very poor GCS like decelerating patients and similar like that, when the patient is to be, outcome is to be poor, we should leave it alone or?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a difficult decision. I'm not suggesting that, you know, it's going to be very easy, but I think appropriate counseling of the relatives in this situation will help. Sit them down and tell them the real risks to everyone. And also with that study that's come out of Wuhan suggesting that surgery for asymptomatic, even those who are asymptomatic for COVID can, you know, push them into the disease and cause higher mortality. And therefore, I think case by case, yes, I think we have to reset our thresholds for what you would operate and what you would not operate. I think we would have gone all out, for example, for certain cases, which we may not do now, knowing that it's going to endanger the lives of a lot of healthcare workers and may not even be in the best interest of the patient or the relatives.
This is a question from our Bangladesh neurosurgeon friends, as well as from Dr. Ansul. They wanted slides, but then you'll have the whole presentation in YouTube recorded and it will be posted in the YouTube channel. It will be there in probably in 2-3 days. Dr. Palani Akman.
Manas, I had a video on the use of the N95 masks. There are queries. So is there any way I can share that video?
I'll just ask the people whether we can integrate the same thing with this. We can add this video. Means the dolphin yawning as
13 minutes. That's why I didn't show the whole video.
Yeah. I'll ask the technical people. Dr. Palaniappan has asked, should we take an additional consent for the increased risk of mortality when we operate?
Yes, certainly.
I think so. Yes, I also agree. 100%.
100%. We have to take the consent, and the consent should mention two things. If the patient turns out to be COVID positive, as pointed out by the excellent study pointed out by Dr. Rajshekar, there's a mortality rate is increased in patients who turned out to be COVID positive. And second thing is, I know the patient's attender should also sign a consent that at least in our hospital, it has been implemented that if there is a chance of me and my attenders getting infected by coming to the hospital, I'm aware of that and I will not hold the hospital authorities responsible for that. So this
we also have started the same thing in our hospital.
Yeah, it should be. This should be treated because otherwise it can lead to medical issues. They will say after coming to the hospital, I got infected. So the entire blame will rest on you.
I agree.
Dr. Chirag from Hyderabad has asked at emergency room, as all patients with the different specialty are put together, how to tackle them?
No, because in the emergency, in emergency room, I think everybody has to follow the protocols, both the patients, the attenders and attendants, everyone has to follow the protocols that Sarath has, you know, outlined. This holds true not only for neurosurgical patients or their attendants, it holds true for everybody in the emergency room. Sarath can elaborate on that.
Dr. Mullik and another doctor have asked, what is the recommendation for taking hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis and how long should we all have to continue, if at all one takes?
Who is it?
Kumar, go ahead and answer.
Manas,
yeah?
A little controversial, but I personally have a different take on this particular issue. ICMR guidelines recommend a particular protocol, but then my discussions with cardiologists and internal medicine people, they have told me that there is only if your ECG, especially for those healthcare workers who are on the older side, if your ECG does not show a prolonged QT interval, there you can take it safely. Or if you have comorbidity and especially cardiac morbidity, if your QT interval is prolonged, there is a risk of sudden cardiac death. And this risk should be made, all the healthcare workers, especially the nurses and others, should be aware of this risk. They should not think this is some sort of a magic bullet. It may help, it may not help, but there is an element of this cardiac arrhythmia in that by using hydroxychloroquine. So you have to be aware of this before you take this. I know
ICMR recommends 400 milligram twice a day first week and then 400 milligram every week for 8 weeks. There's Dr. Manarajita Kumari from Pondicherry has asked, what are the guidelines for tracheostomy and tracheostomy care?
I think I remember the CMC guidelines. Rajshekhar can correct me. To the best extent possible, Rajshekhar, if I am right, it is your guideline says avoid tracheostomy to the extent possible. Am I right?
That's true.
That's true, and all tracheostomies to be done in the operating room. With full PPE, the senior most ENT surgeon available should be doing it, not a resident. And it's one of the most, one of the riskiest procedures for everybody, the operating room personnel, the anesthetists and the ENT surgeons. So please don't do any tracheostomies in the ICU like we used to do earlier. All have to be done in the operating room with full PPE.
It is as though it is a regular, full-fledged, big surgery.
Absolutely.
You should take it as though it's a regular, full-fledged, something like a craniotomy, you should prepare.
Dr. Malla Bhaskar from NIMHANS has asked, the size of the COVID particle is 90 nanometers. What PPE and HEPA filter will filter this viral particle? Dr. Muthukumar.
I'm not sure about the PPE that will filter, but the articles, literature publications in the PPE, maybe Sarath can answer the question. The HIPAA filter, many of the articles regarding the use of ventilation and the ventilation ducts in the OTs, they say that they should have a HIPAA filter which will that is supposed to reduce the contamination.
So when I went through the literature, there is absolutely no kind of consensus whether the HEPA filter can actually filter. They say that yes, it can definitely, HEPA filter has to be used. There's no doubt about it. But they say that you should not clean your duct. So just nobody should think that once, because you know, if you clean the duct, it's going to be better. So everybody has advised against it. The humidifier, the humidity, there's no point changing the humidity level. It should be maintained anywhere between 25% to 30%. The air conditioners should run 24/7. And in the administrative blocks, they should start running at least 2 hours before they come and 2 hours after they go, even though under reduced circumstances. Then the dampers have to be closed. This has been an unequivocal suggestion. So once we, even if there are filters, the dampers have to be closed. So with this, 100% air comes inside and 100% air goes outside. And the flow also has to be maintained very high. Like you mentioned in the OT, about 25 per hour is the high rate of flow has to be mentioned. This definitely is going to compromise on the cooling mechanisms. But again, that is something which has to be taken. The problem of taking split air conditioners or window air conditioners is that they have very limited clearing mechanisms. And so if there is any aerosol or any droplet, so they will continue remaining in that room and it's much more riskier. So it is okay for your personal room, it is okay for homes, but definitely not in a public location. So if you don't have a central air conditioners, even if you open the windows, run the fans, that's good enough. I was seeing some comments that in our government hospitals, we don't have, you know, we don't have central air conditioners. We have, so in which case running a fan and opening the windows, I think is much more safer than running the split infusion windows.
Yeah, actually there are lots of questions. We have 58 plus 37, 100 questions, and we are already 8:42. I'll forward and I'll request all the speakers to answer in the chat box after, and so that because we have a time limit till what time we keep on discussing.
Manas,
yes.
Can I suggest that we'll answer them through email? That'll yes. be the easiest thing to do, and I can do it over the next day or two at the moment. You know, within a day or two, whatever, the questions are addressed to me or even the other questions, which I can answer. My side, I think that will be better because I can see the number of participants, I think, is slowly dropping. And I think people are getting tired.
Yeah, and there is a request that you should have the YouTube link placed in the NSI website by Dr. Ari, which Dr. Muthukumar can decide on that.
Yes.
I'm sending my PowerPoint presentation.
Manas, if you can send this, we will put it up on the NSI website. No problem.
Okay. Thank you. I'd like to thank all the audience. There was almost 300 people participating and all the speakers, Professor Muthukumar, Professor Rajshekar, and Professor Sarath, for agreeing in a very short time. And because this is something which is day-to-day requirement from a person working, neurosurgeon working in a smaller district place to an institute. The protocols are almost similar. And if we do not take care of ourselves, we'll be bad for our family, but it will be bad for the whole fraternity in the department and the patients also. With these few words, I'd like to close the webinar. And I would like to thank the sponsors, Icon, for taking care of the logistics, and Mr. Sriram, who managed so well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.